In this video, I'm going to be showing you how to finalize the initial ETL load. We are going to look at how to generate the EDW layer of the data warehouse, where the data is put in its final form. We are going to look at how to create the date dimension. And we are also going to look at how to generate and update surrogate keys for data. But before we proceed to that, I would like to first show you a new dimensional model that I have created for the EDW layer. As you can see, I've added a date dimension on the lower right-hand corner. We will get to that in a minute. You will also see that for all the other tables now have a surrogate key ID as their primary key on all the dimension tables, and the foreign key relationships with the fact sales table has also been updated so that it's now referencing the surrogate keys that I've created for the dimension tables. On the lower right hand side, you will see the dim date dimension. It also has a surrogate key. This surrogate key, as you will see in our implementation in a second, is slightly different from the surrogate keys on the dimension tables. Then you will see that the attributes of that dimension table is date, day, month, month name, week, quarter, year, day of week, and weekday name. You have several options here for the date dimension. Usually in a real business context, you will also have a reference as to whether or not a given date is within the fiscal year and the fiscal quarter or the fiscal month, because that is slightly different than a normal calendar year. But for our purpose, we will stick to a date dimension that looks like this. First, we need to create the tables for our EDW data layer. As you can see, I'm creating the tables here on the dim date dimension. DID refers to the surrogate key for date dimension. I'm going to create that slightly different than the surrogate keys on the different other dimensions in our data warehouse. So first create a table for date dimension, then alter that same table to add the constraint that makes the DID the primary key on the table. In the next section, I'm creating my dim customer table. I have this CID. I'm going to create that as an identity field, which means that each time this table, a new record is inserted into this table, it's going to increment this int. And since this is going to be the new primary key of the table, I need to enforce a not null on this, then alter that table to make CID the primary key. Then I'm repeating that for employee, I'm repeating it for product, I'm repeating it for shipper. And on the fact sales table, you can now see I don't have the business keys anymore because I'm referencing now the dimension tables through their surrogate keys. And of course, since these are going to be in a foreign key relationships with the dimension tables, I also need them to be not null on the fact sales table. And then my measures. Then alter fact sales table to add the constraint that makes the primary key of the table a composite of all the foreign key relationships to all the dimension tables. Then alter all the fact sales table to add foreign key relationships to all the dimension tables. And you can see here that the dim date is referenced twice. That is because I have both a date for putting in the order and for a ship date. I will first show you how I've created this persistent date dimension, and then I will return to discussing my design choices for this dimension using Kimball a little bit later in this video. So first, you see here that I am creating the table if it does not exist. This is, since we just created the table, this is going to be just an unnecessary check, really. But in case it's not created, it will create it here. Then in the next part, I'm using a while loop in SQL to actually create the persistent date dimension according to my design. And the way I'm going to do this is that I'm setting a start date that I'm choosing. So this is going to be the first time in my database that I actually see some data. And then I'm going to set an end date. And here I'm taking the year that we're in now and then adding 100. So I'm basically just generating a persistent date dimension that's going to last me 100 years. That should be enough. You can also just set today's date for this example, since there is not going to be any new records in your source systems. It's a dead system, right? But in case you were to make this for an actual company, you would need to fill enough dates into this date dimension that you can actually cover all your use cases for the foreseeable future. Otherwise, you're going to have to update it every week, and that's a waste of resources. Then while start date is less than end date, begin insert into all the fields of my dimension table, then select them, and I'm now using different built-in functions in SQL to get the date part from start date, which was set to be the 1st of January 1996, and then I'm casting those in to names of the different attributes up here. This is actually also unnecessary. We don't need it since we know what the names are going to be here. Then when I'm done doing that, I'm adding just one day to the start date. So this now increments by one and it starts over. And this is going to continue until the while argument here is false. And that's going to be false once the start date surpasses the end date. And that's how I generate all my records in my date dimension. If you look on page 254 in the Kimball book, he writes, "It is a mistake to use a SQL date format field as the join key between the date dimension table and the fact table. First, a date format key is typically 8 bytes, so you're wasting 4 bytes in the fact table for every date key in every row. Second, a date format field can't easily accommodate special date dimension rows to identify an unknown date or future date. These special cases can be handled gracefully with a surrogate date key." But let's look at what I actually did for the surrogate key on the date dimension. Let's execute the select get date. So you can actually see that I start out with a today's date in a date time format. Then I declare date as date time and I set date to be today's date. Then I use convert to convert this date time date into a char data type with 8 characters long. And I use date for this. So if I execute this bit, you can now see that I'm actually returning today's date in a char 8 format. And when I insert that into my DID on my date dimension, which is an integer, I have it converted into being an int. So it actually turns out that my surrogate key is a integer that is actually does have some intelligence. It's not just a typical surrogate key that doesn't have any meaning, because this does have a meaning. It refers back to what the actual entry in the dimension table means, that it is today's date. The problem with this is if I use this surrogate key to start building visualizations later, and then I cast it to get the year and I cast it to get the month, I'm going to have severe performance impacts. So if you do this, you have to promise that whenever you want to actually build a visualization or build a report, that you're actually going to use the actual attributes on the date dimension and not the surrogate key itself. The benefits to making the surrogate key is that first of all, when you're debugging or working with your data warehouse, this dimension key that you're often going to use to find records is actually intelligent, that you know what it is, and it's easier to work with for debugging purposes when you're a developer. But the overarching argument and the best argument for using this is that later you can use it to performance tune your data warehouse, since the surrogate key for for your date dimension is going to appear on every row in your fact table, then you can partition your fact table, which is going to grow to be very long, so that the older years or the older months that are not likely to be queried as often can be put in other files and perhaps even on other slower servers to maximize your performance in your data warehouse. So that's why I've done it. Now I'm going to load data into my dimension tables, and that is as simple as getting the data from my stage table and inserting it into my EDV dimension table. And as you can see, the surrogate key is not included in the insert statement, and that is because the surrogate key on the dimension table is an identity table that automatically increments for every insert row. So if I execute this statement, it will now insert rows into all the dimension tables. In this next part, we insert all the fact row tables in our EDV stage EDV data layer. And in order to do this, we need to look up the surrogate keys that we just created by inserting records and generating an int identity surrogate key for all the dimension tables. By selecting the statements and writing joins to all the dimension tables, we can ensure that we are getting the correct surrogate keys. And we can verify this by writing our select statement, executing it, and then making sure to insert it into the EDV fact sales table. So by executing this, we will now insert all the records in the table.